Hey, welcome to a new Project Kamp update. So we bought this big piece of land and are prototyping a more sustainable way of living. Not sure how it's gonna go, but let's see. And at this moment, we're in a transition phase where the days are getting shorter, winter is coming, it's getting colder, more rain is coming, basically living autumn. And this means we have to do a few things, prepare ourselves a little bit, but it also comes with a few interesting new opportunities, like for instance, mushrooms.
Here we have some mushrooms. They are the fruits of autumn and wetland. Rain is coming and it's announcing different season, and mushrooms are all over the land. We personally don't know much about mushrooms, so we don't know which ones we can eat, but it's just amazing to walk through the land and discovering all the different shapes and colors around the trees, the soil, grass, wetlands. And here are some shots of the mushrooms. You can see them and maybe you can help out to see if there are some mushrooms we can eat. Besides the mushrooms that have been growing on the land, also our plants have been growing on the land a lot. But these ones were different because these ones were planted by us 6 months ago in a very small state. We have been drinking a lot of very delicious fresh tea, and now it's time to chop them down, dry the herbs and drink also the tea during winter. Have our harvest, our tea for the winter, and we will dry it up in the most decent roof we have in our land. And another harvest that needs to be made is grape harvesting, and the neighbors ask for some help, so Adrian and Julie will go and help them.
So today is Vendima. We are gonna go to our neighbor to grape picking. We have never done it. It looks super exciting. They gather all together. Is it one day in a year that they do this activity? Do it together. It needs to be fast because the grapes otherwise get bad, or if you go earlier they are not good enough. So today is the day to go grape picking.
Apanho por baixo aqui, apanho de um lado e apanho do outro.
Tudo, tem lá a fotografia, vá!
Tudo!
Tudo! Tudo, mas tem que olhar para lá, porque senão não vê, hein?
São baldes de tinta.
Tia, tira fora que vem lá a gente!
Não, por aqui não!
A gente carrega isso tudo.
Não, vale a
pena. We already picked all the grapes. Now we are gonna head the house of Fernando and Antonio to split the grapes from the branches. And Julie, how was the day?
Yeah, it was very nice. We were doing grape picking for around 3 hours with the neighbors and all their friends, because they all gathered together to do this as kind of a group activity. And they keep on going for the rest of the day, but we said that for now it's enough. But yeah, let's see the results. In a couple of months they will be done and we can try them out.
So besides harvesting things from the land, another thing which is autumn is good for is to start thinking about your forest, because it's a good moment to plant trees. But we don't know that much about it, especially not in this area and also on a burned down land, like what to do with it. So on YouTube we met this guy who actually lives like 20 minutes away. And he bought a piece of land with his family a few years ago and he's been already recovering it.
Hi, so welcome. This is the Quinta da Bolsinha. Germano, Dian, Joaquin and Simon. We have moved to the place in 2017 after a few years abroad, and we have been recovering it similar to your wonderful project on the camp. And we like to share some lessons, some failures, some curiosities about the land and what we have been doing so far. When the forest fire passes through one of our local forests, you have some trees that survive. And they survive because they are Mediterranean species, they are used to fire, they are used to very high temperatures. Like this cork tree, where the cork is actually an envelope that protects them from fire and they resist. So they come back after the fire and they survive. When it comes to the eucalyptus plantations and they burn at a very high temperature, there's nothing that stops the fire because they are pyrophil species. So they actually burn and enjoy the fire to make the cleaning of the rest of the species and to feed them, basically. So when they burn, like the forest that you see behind, they come back very quickly and everything else becomes asphyxiated in the forest.
So it's your mission to remove the eucalyptus and bring more native trees back?
Exactly. So when we saw that happening in 2017, our decision was bring back the native species and take out the eucalyptus systematically and from the roots, so eliminate them from the land. We have done that in different stages. So the first stage was really to trade the eucalyptus wood for the machinery to actually lift up the stumps. The second stage was to restore some of the trees that had survived, the oaks, the cork trees and some of the chestnut trees. And then the next stage was to start populating or repopulating the land with the seed or with planted trees. Okay, so first step was to eliminate the eucalyptus, and to do that, before we actually got into doing it, we actually negotiate with a few of the wood traders and we trade the wood for the machinery to take at the roots. So these are the roots of eucalyptus. Some of the roots were a kilometer long in the land, close to. We had to dig holes 4 meters deep for some of the older eucalyptus to take them out, and we put them all here and now they are housing for wild rabbits in the back. It took 1 week to take 1 hectare of eucalyptus out. After the extraction of all of the eucalyptus roots, we looked at the land and what had survived, the machinery movement and also the summer, because by then we were at the end of the summer of 2017. And some of the trees, like this cork tree, survived from a burned stick that was in the middle of the land, completely alone, to actually green up the leaves and the branches. The same happened with strawberry trees, with some of the oaks that had burned. That cork tree also survived but got completely carbonized. It took a year or so for it to get green again. And it's still, we have not taken the cork out, so it's still with the black cork from the fire. Years on. Next step after recovering the trees, we basically did a bit of desk planning. We took some aerial photos. We had the topography of the land, so the levels and the different lines. And we start looking at patterns of planting in order to facilitate three things. One, the wind and the fire protection. to make sure that if we did have a fire in the future, there will be some lines of fire cut, which is the kind that we built here. It's a big separator to keep clean for fire prevention. We looked at winter cold wind, which comes down the hill, and we looked at water retention. And for water retention, we used the kind of one main swale to stop the water, because it's very clay soil, to stop the water from washing down and to keep some retained in here. And from that, we start having major patterns, lines of planting, and you can see how the oaks are starting to recover along the line here. And we keep that also to facilitate cleaning with a mulcher or with some machinery that comes in. So when it mulches along the lines and it doesn't damage the small trees that are coming up. This was seeded. This is a seeded tree. Yeah, so this is a seeded oak from a seed that is probably 2 to 3 years old. This is a sweet chestnut from seed as well, that was seeded along the pattern with the other trees. It's a tree that was seeded and we planted it in 2018. So it was just the spring of 2018.
So it's 3 years old?
It's 3 years old, yeah. And this area of the land is the driest and the more challenging one for the trees to thrive. This is the end of the summer, it's the harvest time. So we have some of the cowpeas, which grow really well here. And from the forest, what we get are the chestnuts, which start in September and then have different varieties all the way to November. Let me try to get one. So you can actually dry the chestnuts and eat them as a candy. This is the sweet chestnut.
Mm.
And this is no effort food. We do nothing to them.
Yeah.
We have the walnuts, which were just a simple local Juglans Royal, the local variety. And over there you have the acorns that we picked up to bring to the Kamp forest for seeding and trying to get the mimosas into oaks. You know, it's the typical harvesting from the sky. You get it on your head and it hurts.
I noticed.
The acorns are also used for animal feed. The acorns for you to seed or to do a nursery at your land, at the camp. This is one variety of oaks. This is from another variety of the oaks in the land, and this is the biggest acorn size from another, yet another type of oak. They are all pretty much the same species, but what we have noticed is that they lose the leaves and they get the leaves in the spring at different timings. And that makes it interesting to manage, for example, if you want to shade your house or if you want to shade a vegetable plot in the summer, or if you want to do some early spring planting and you want those acorns, those oaks, to be of a variety that loses the leaf earlier or later.
So back in our land, and now we have a lot of acorns. They have to go back to the land. Ideally, we would dig little holes and put them inside, but realistically, this will be the way we will do it and hope for the best. Besides working with seeds, there is also cuts that we can do in the trees and make them grow. And this is what we did with the willow tree. Here we have a young willow tree, and it's super cool to have a bit of more diversity on this land. And a few weeks ago, Freddy was here and he found a branch on the floor and he was making some cuttings out of the branch. He put them into a bucket with water, and now we have little willow trees all around. We will just put them into the soil and hope for the best to have a few more diverse trees on the land. We don't know if this is going to become a big tree or not, but for now it's just very good to plant new trees on the soil.
Mm.
So another update we have to do is with our energy storage. We need to upgrade it. So a few updates ago, you could see us setting up our solar system. So we have a few panels on the roof, then all the electronics and a 10 kilowatt battery pack to store all the electricity. But now to get ready for the winter, we need to upgrade. And there are a few reasons for that. So one reason is that we recently installed water system, which needs a pump to pump the water here, which takes electricity. And originally we thought this wouldn't be around here on base camp because the water, we will find it somewhere else. So we probably need to have our own solar system somewhere else just for the pump. But then we found water super close by, so we figured we could just put the pump to the same system. But the system wasn't really designed for that capacity. So due to having the water pump, we need to upgrade. In the recent days, we had a few more people visiting and we realized it scales up pretty quickly. If more people come, the usage goes up. So it's kind of inevitable that we just need to scale up our battery pack. And the last one is also just really in winter, you have way more cloudy days. So you would harvest much less sun during the day or even a few days in a row, which means you just need to store it somewhere. Otherwise, you're not gonna have electricity. And it's actually fun. I've been observing a lot, monitoring the system and how it goes practically every day. Is you get a lot of sun, way more than you can store. So the battery pack is full at around 5 o'clock in the night. Then you stop harvesting sun and slowly everything you use from then on is just the battery pack. So it goes down, 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 down. And in the morning it's around 50% usually with two people. And then it goes up again. So that's kind of a reoccurring pattern. But if you have a few days in a row cloud, that means it cannot recharge itself. So the next day you start at 50% and it goes down again. Yeah, we kind of saw this problem coming as we scale up. So the 10 kilowatt battery pack right here, there's place for exactly another one of these, which would just double our capacity. So I'm gonna do that and then we should be good electricity wise for the winter. So besides storing the energy we get from our solar panels in our battery, there are also other ways to store this energy. And we actually installed something new. Let me show you. It's an electric boiler to heat up the water. This thing right here. We actually already brought it from Netherlands, so it's been here the whole time, but we just didn't hook it up. So what this does, it basically just heats up the water. But it's a good way to store extra energy you have it into the water. So this is basically a big battery, and the main reason to do it is during the day we just have a lot of moments when we generate more electricity and the battery is already full, so you have this extra energy you want to put into something, which is this thing. But what we don't want is to use this thing heating up overnight, because then it really uses the energy from the battery and we want it to use the energy from the sun directly. So we want to make sure it only is turned on during the day when the sun is shining. So now we actually installed this timer. So it only goes on like at 8 in the morning until 4 in the afternoon when the sun is shining. However, the ideal scenario would be that it's linked to our solar setup. So it understands once the battery is full, only then we start charging or heating up the water here to make sure the battery always has first priority. And we can actually do this with our current solar system. It's a Victron Energy Cerbo GX. So there's a relay in there that could turn on and off, but it needs to be programmed. So someone is interested, let me know. Until then, I guess we use this one. So yeah, and the cool thing is, besides just storing all our energy that we harvest, we also just have hot water, which also means hot showers. Yeah, this is good. All right, so that was it for this video. It's kind of nice actually to slowly get ready for winter. It's kind of a different sad thing, having a hot shower. Some cozy days, but we still need to get better prepared though, because for instance the pizza oven and the container still need a roof to protect us from the rain. We already had a bunch of roof tiles, but that's for the next videos. So if you want to see that, make sure to subscribe. That was it for now. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video.